Penny for your thoughts.
I hate Brenda, and a bad guy hit me in the shin, and I peed all in my pants.
There's nothing a little music can't help. Rockin', rockin' and rollin'. Down to the beach I'm strollin'. But the seagulls poke in my head. Not fun. I said, seagulls, stop it now. Said seagulls gonna come, poke me in the coconut, and they did, and they did, had me going like, nothing I could do but yell when these birds attack me. When I tried to run, I fell, and then these kids start laughing, and then got hit in the neck with a hacky sack.
Backpack while you run, 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 jump and stop.
Put me down. I love to groove and boogie. Yeah.
Great.
Show you some dance moves.
No, I don't want you to.
If I had your giant feet out there on the beach, could about run those birds.
You're a psycho wiener.
Let me grab my beater. When the time is right, birds will back your face.
Now run, 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 jump. I can be your backpack while you run. Swing from a hairy vine. I can be your backpack while you climb. Stand on one hand and lift rocks with your special gift. Run, 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 jump. Now breathe.
That's good. Like that.
Wear that outfit again. Check. But if you wanna keep your speed,
because I want to fit in. Sorry, you're just not terribly important to me.
Did you know that when you used to step, you would be her phone number one single song. We should see each other anymore. We never was supposed to be. Gotta return some videotapes. Have to return some videotapes. Did you know I'm utterly insane? I like to dissect girls that ate some of their brains. Gotta return some videotapes. I'm really late. Gotta
I guess I would probably be returning videotapes.
Hey, what up, everybody? What's going on, Sean? You got the face filter on, man? You got the smooth shot
still?
Going?
Still?
I don't know, do you? I'm asking.
Let me check.
Oh.
Well, I got to do settings?
You probably have to turn it on.
Oh.
You know, I just let the natural, you know, beautiful complexion of my skin.
Touch my appearance?
Speak for itself.
Take that off?
That's what I do. Yeah.
Oh, now it looks like I'm 50.
Yeah, look at that. Yeah, put all it back right. on. Get back in your 20s, you know? Utilize technology.
All right. Screw that.
Welcome, everybody, to Appreciating Comic Book Art Live. New time. I'm sorry if that's messing some people up out there. We're new time at 9:30. We're going to see how this rolls. Part of that is I started a brand new job Monday. Going very well. I dig it. It's fun.
Can you say congratulations, chat?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. As fun as a job can be. You know, as fun as a job can be. I had to quit my old job because the boss
milking cows.
Yeah, he was trying to get me fired. I was just like, you know, fuck that shit. I'm out. And I walked out. It was awesome. I wish I could have done that permanently, but we'll see. Maybe in the future, as they say. Let's see, here on The Steadfast was the first. Says, hail the chat. Hail to you, man.
What's up?
Member of the channel, Rick Saylor, says, what's up, everyone?
What's up, Jay?
What's up, brother? MB Bonner, Core 20 Ooh. Fire. Yes, we're getting there. Getting there. 19. Oh, there we go. Core 20. Just hit it. We got 7 over on Rumble. 15 watching here, so we can officially say hashtag Core 20.
C20
#C20. All right, love you guys. Thank you for being here, and shout out to everybody watching over on Rumble. We did have a member chat to start the day off.
What?
Cosmic Studios member for 3 months says, watched this DVD many times years ago. Looking forward to reviewing with you all. Hail, hell yeah! This DVD is single-handedly helped my progression and my jump in my. My art abilities at the time, single-handedly. So I want to give a fair warning out there to everybody. There is a possibility the stream could be struck tonight as we're reviewing this. I don't know. I don't know what the copyright laws are with this. We're not going to have any volume going. I'm going to try to pause it so we're not just watching it straight through, and hopefully that'll be fine. But if we lose the stream at some point, just stick with us because we'll pull the DVD or the video off, and then hopefully the stream will come back live, and then we'll just we'll figure it out from there. So just fair warning, everybody. We got Mark Pengren in the house. Says Splat.
Yes. Yeah.
I tell you what, that was the coolest name, right?
Splat.
Growing up in the 90s, yeah, when you saw like Splat on the comic book, like it's just, it was like, man, I was like, yeah, hell yeah.
I just did that. Yeah.
Yeah. I did it all over the comic. What? Duck Bacon's in the house. Says, hail Joe, hail Sean, hail Kayla, hail the chat. Yes, Kayla is not with us. Forgot to mention, sorry. I think Kayla had a very rough, tiring day, and she just needed the day off to relax and recuperate. So hopefully she jumps in the chat at some point, but just get some rest, and we'll see you next Tuesday. We got Peter Palmiotti in the house. Said, it's all about the splat. Yes.
Sup, Peter?
Yes. Core 20 from John. Hail, brother.
Yeah.
Good to see you. We got Darmax. What up? What up to you?
Nice.
I don't know if I've seen that name in there in the chat.
How's it going?
Good to see you. Thank you for being here. Apex Comics is in the house. Good to see you. We got Art 9 too. I think that might be a new name. I don't know if I've seen that name either.
Yeah.
Thank you for joining us. I hope you enjoyed the show. Hit the like, hit the bellifications. You get notifications every time we go live and look at amazing art. Tonight is a little bit more unique because we are looking at one of the great 90s artists doing a tutorial, even though we're not going to actually hear him talk. We will replace that with our beautiful voices just so we don't try not to get struck. But we'll see what happens. We got Paulus Arts in the house. Hail, brother. Good to see you. Let's see. Yes, there was the member chat. Thank you. Member of the channel, Astro Zombie, is in the house as well.
Yeah.
Hail the chat. Hail to you.
Mm-hmm.
Who else we got here? Johnson Benjamin. I'm down for any splat. Yes,
there
sir.
There you go.
Yes, sir. We got the man in the house, Jay. Desolate Soul
brother?
Studios. What's going on? Congratulations. Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it. Chuck Lee, hello. Your intro is way too long. That was actually a short version of it. And the reason why I run long intros is the notification for the show going live goes out at different times to different people. So I don't want people to miss the show, so I run a longer intro. Usually it's no more than 6 minutes, you know. And then we do this intro, we talk a little bit, we say hi to the chat, to the people that usually tune in, the Core 20. They're here both on YouTube and Rumble.
I'm like a 2 minute guy myself.
Oh, there you go. Mm-hmm. I'm a 1 minute one pump chump. Is that what they said back in the day? Lieutenant Hughes, member of the channel, is in the house. Here I am, just finished new episodes of Ahsoka.
I haven't caught it yet.
Okay, straight up, I tried watching it the other day. Now, granted, it was late at night. It was on the weekend. It was like at midnight. Yeah. As bored as hell.
I have no urge to watch TV.
So maybe it's going to get better. We'll see. I'll give it another chance. I'll give episode two a chance. But this is, I'm getting a little tired of all these Star Wars shows coming out and just being boring right off the bat. What was it? Andor was the same way.
Oh, that was like so
four
boring.
Four episodes was boring as hell.
And then you get people like, you don't understand it. It's like, shut up.
Yeah, I was like, I understand. Entertain me. You know, yeah. Give me some Jedi action, like some really good stuff.
TIE fighters just going pew, pew, pew. Like, I'm simple.
Drawn Sword Graphics, Hail, says SWAT, slap, and swong. Green Laser's in the house.
Yeah, good to see
you. Also, Jay Ryan, what's going on, brother? Sean keeping it real, yet still full 30 minute over his actual time. That's true. Yeah, embellish a little bit, you know. Soka, these nuts. Okay, so this, what we're going to watch tonight was a DVD that was put out in, what, the early 2000s?
Like 7 or 8, maybe 6.
Yeah, something like that. And it was a fun DVD. I remember purchasing it, and it was the first time that I got to see a comic book artist explain how to draw, so to speak, like how their process was. You know, like before that, I was just looking at books. I was imitating the best I could, and just drawing what I thought natural came to me. When I saw this DVD, though, and I followed this exact process for the longest time, and I've got a kind of a before and after example. I'm gonna show you guys at the end of the show of what I was doing before I saw this DVD, and then how I progressed specifically because of the DVD after it. So you'll see the progression there. But we're gonna bring this up. It's the original DVD was 2 hours long. I sped it up for an hour to get through it. So, but this is something we're just gonna kind of talk about, mostly process. So Sean, first off, Tark's Nine member for 14 months. Yes,
you.
Says Hail Comics Geek. Hail to you, brother. Look, I missed Cosmic Studios member chat as well. So let me give out some Dr. Fishies.
Dr. Fishy, no. You see,
that's for Cosmic, and we'll do us the chopper.
Death of the chopper.
Thank you guys. I appreciate you guys very, very much. All right, Sean, I want to jump into explaining what he is talking about in the DVD right here with process of thumbnails to layouts.
Sure. Well, what he's doing is breaking down the composition just to get it at a thumbnail, which is essentially the size of your thumb or your hand, where because with the 11 by 17 is so daunting, you want to get as much information as you can without winging it and really essentially saving time. And with this, you could get a bulk of the composition, you could work on the lighting or just have a rough idea. And now he's going into his inks, and then you could go through a couple of them, whatever you choose you feels better for your actual page or cover, and then to transfer it to Lightbox. And it saves you a lot of time as opposed to hours of just scribbling and scratching away on the page. And it's really efficient. Nowadays, you could do it on your iPad or digital tablet just by shrinking the image and then zooming in. So, this is a method I've done for a long time as well. It's a time saver. Sometimes you lose a little bit of the energy, but you're not supposed to be going full with the process of making a complete image. But as you can see, as he's developing what he wants for the page, he's getting all the information he needs and then just work it out from there, and really doesn't take so long, anywhere from like 40 minutes to an hour tops really should be spending on that. That's just if you're like nitty picky on everything, but it doesn't got to be pretty.
And when you think about it, the size thumbnail he's doing right now is probably no bigger than, you know, maybe a little bit bigger than a sketch card would be.
So and
different artists do different size thumbnails. Some do like, you know, bigger, almost 8.5 by 11 thumbnails, or you know, whatever works for them. But specifically his is, you know, I'd say like, what, 5 by 3, maybe? Not even that. Probably a little bit smaller than that. And what's interesting about this is what Sean was saying, like when you draw small like this, it's easier to get the proportions looking better. And that's why they do it, like especially anatomy. You know, like when you're drawing in the big, you know, 11 by 17, we're drawing 11 by 17 on comic paper. And if we're drawing like full size splash pages or whatever, sometimes, yeah, proportions can get a little wonky because it's such a big canvas that we're drawing on. But the idea is you shrink it up and you're able to tell the figure work a lot better and smaller. And here he actually goes in pretty damn detailed.
Yeah.
He starts out with the pencils, goes over it with a pen, and then does a lot of shadowing. So he has an idea of what he wants to do for the final piece.
If you look what he's doing, like the final version of this layout, of this sketch, it's a lot more rendered and well done than most established artists.
Yeah, 100%. Like,
yeah.
I mean, that's, you could sell that as a sketch card and make bank. I mean, you really could. Like, that's insane. Art9 said that's what Rob Liefeld taught. Yes, Liefeld was big with doing that. In fact, Murat Michael started out as an assistant, actually taking those pencils from the blow up and drawing them on the paper.
Yeah, he would transfer to the board. Malin did the same thing for, I think it might have been some Youngblood stuff. Probably some other projects as well that hopefully see the light of day. But yeah. And you know what, like transferring your art from the light board, a lot of people dig into it. Like they're actually drawing on it, doing a finish. That's not what you do. You gotta lightly, gentle, just get the information there. Because if you erase it, you're gonna have smears, you're gonna tear up the paper. You just lightly go over it. And then once you have your whole figure or page laid out, then you do the tightening. Then you do the actual penciling and the nitty gritty completion of the work. But damn, this is fire.
It's kind of interesting that he's given himself, granted this is a tutorial, but he's given himself a couple different options for this piece that he's drawing. And I think he ends up going with the third one. But all these options that he draws out are really cool.
Yeah.
Like this one's badass too. The one he ends up going for is pretty good. The first one is cool. I like the dynamics there. I'm always a big fan of straight on shots when it comes to the big character in a layout like this. I just like that, especially a character like that, kind of like a monstrous design. Yeah.
And like I've been using notepads, but bigger ones, like compared to your standard notepad, sticky pad. Like, see this?
Okay, yeah.
So this one's kind of more conducive to a page size. Yeah.
Yeah, but look at all this. I mean, honestly, look at all the detail and information he puts in here.
Yeah. He might be showing off for the video, and that's awesome. That, like, we're winning on that, like, by far, by getting such more of a rendered finished piece out of this. But yeah, this is great. She looks so sad. She's like, duh.
And here's the third one. I think this is the one he actually finally goes with. John said would be fun for a future stream if you had Kelsey Scribble's book and could find the final comics pages for the comparison. Fun to see where the final images come from. That'd be cool. We gotta get Kelsey back on. That was a hell of a fun show.
He's a good guy.
4x6. That's probably about right. You're probably about right on that. Yep. They had Copies Fineliner. They had Copics. I'm thinking
Copies.
Is it Copies? Copics or Copies?
I don't know.
Fineliners back then. Yeah. I'm thinking you're saying Copics, but I could be wrong on that.
I know they're probably using like Pigma or Micron.
It is a long process. It does save time in the end because you are doing so much of the thinking of the layout in the smaller part of it. So that once this is done, you've done all the design, you've done all the thinking. So when you blow it up, all you really have to do is go in and then basically render. So if you transfer it from the paper on the light box to the new paper, you do it loosely, try to keep the energy. You do the loose outline of it and then just go right in and start rendering. And you have all this information, you know? So, I mean, when I started doing this, it was a faster process and it worked. It really worked for a while. And then one day I kind of started going back to my process now, which is just right to the board to just capture the energy and just create the page or the design as I go. But this is a great process. I like this. And there have been times when I've been working on a cover or something like that and I'm struggling that I will kind of go back to kind of this idea of going to thumbnails, or like Sean said, I'll go on the iPad and just do a digital sketch loosely and get everything the way I want it and then print that out and blow it up. And it's kind of like similar thing.
Yeah. It's all about time management. Like, oh, what's up, brother? Good to see you.
Hail El Guapo Comics says, dang, I missed 20 minutes of this. What's up, fellas? What is up to you, brother? Doing good, man. Just looking at who asked? Apex Comics asked this too. So Stephen Platt. This is a Genomen?
Nomen?
I don't know how you pronounce it.
I don't even know him.
DVD that came out in the early mid-2000s. And it was, it was a DVD that was pivotal in my exploration and learning and study of comic book art. David Finch came out with one of these too, but this was the first one I saw, and it opened my eyes so much more to comic book drawing at the time, because at the time I was just looking at comics and drawing, trying to figure out how my favorite artist drew and just study line work and then try to recreate that on my own on the paper. When I watched this DVD, and for the first time I'm like, okay, there's a certain process, and I started following this process of doing the thumbnailing, then blow it up on a copier, put it on a light box, put it onto another paper, and boom, it's right there, and then you just start rendering it out. And I'm going to show at the end, if you missed the beginning of the show, at the end of the show, I'm going to show you guys an example of where I was at before I watched this DVD, and then where my art went afterwards, and like how I progressed afterwards. It's pretty interesting to see the change.
And you know, Rob was the first one to kind of like throw this idea of doing it out there in the comic book greats, but he didn't show any example. I don't know if it's because they didn't have the production behind it to do it, but this is the first time where you actually got this in depth of an artist doing the process. And it was like Joe says, like, yeah, game changer. Fucking game changer.
Yeah, I think the last comment was talking about Copics, because Chuck Lee, by the way, welcome to the chat, Chuck. Said it looks like he was using a Copic pen. I didn't know they had them back then. Me either. Honestly, I didn't even know about Copics until a few years back, 5 years or so ago, when I saw Silvestri. But that is absolutely looks like a Copic.
Well, Copics, well, the markers were actually based for female animators for doing animation. And they just got so huge out in, I guess, Japan that came over here like maybe a decade or so ago. Yeah.
I like Copics. The only thing that bothers me about Copics and why I don't use them as my main inking tool is that the ink comes up when you're erasing finished pencils.
Yeah, and you know, it's kind of a pain in the dick to break them. Like break them in the sense of with Pigment, not the Microns, but the Pigment ones, you can kind of break them and you can kind of chisel shit out like doing a quill. It's weird.
Yeah, I love Copics. Like, I love the smoothness of them for
their
drawing.
Their blacks feels are really, very stark.
Yeah, yeah, it feels really nice. And I like the different sizes. You can get like the really small, like the 003 size or whatever. And I really get some fine detail in there, but they also have very fine tips, and I'm heavy-handed.
Yeah.
So a lot of times I will go through Copic markers very quickly. Sheldon said, I still have Copic markers from college back in, wow.
Yeah, look, the great thing about them is
they don't last that long.
They are expensive, but you could change out the nibs, you could change out the cartridges, you could refill the ink, so it is an investment. But in the long run, like, let's say you buy one marker, let's go with markers for now, buy one marker, buy one refill, you get like 16 markers out of the one. So you're,
that's true,
16 for two, like probably the same thing with the inks.
By the way, a member of the channel, Sheldon Martin, in the house. Thank you. We have Curious Comics in the house. Says hail to you.
Hail to you.
Okay, so here we go. Here is a switch up. If you guys missed that, let me back it up real quick, because this is on a sped up. So this is the design he's going with that he was excited about, was satisfied with, got all his rendering done, and now we jump to the blown up version put on a light box. This opened my mind too, like, you know, get the blown up version, put on a light box, go buy a light box, really interesting, and then boom, there you go.
Well, your dad made you yours, right?
My first light box was made by my dad. Yeah, it was kind of cool because I didn't know where to get light boxes at the time. We lived out in the country, and I didn't know about art stores, anything like that back in friggin', you know, the early 2000s. And my dad was, so he was a carpenter, Mm-hmm. And so he's like, I'll build you one. And I'll tell you what, that was the best light box I ever had. Brightness wise. No,
I remember you brought it to Chicago. I was like, what the fuck is this?
Did I?
Yeah. Nice. There's an hotel, right? That was the coolest thing.
Nice. Yeah, it was the brightest of all the light boxes I've ever owned. Yeah, like that was what's up. Like the light box I have now is okay. Mm-hmm. I use it for random stuff, you know. But okay, here he's going. He's doing a very loose outline of everything that he just kind of rendered out in with pen and everything. So making sure all that information is there, and you're gonna see like how odd it looks when you take the back off and it's just the outline. So I mean, that's one thing that kind of throws you off a little bit, because if you don't know what you're doing, you can kind of screw yourself up.
Don't know what you're doing.
That's what it looks like. You know, yeah. Now compare that. Let me see if I go back here. Compare that to that, you know, that tight. Look at the tight outline there, you know. And now we get back to what it looks like when you pull it off. Oh, went too far. Damn it. I'm failing here, people.
Mm.
Okay. Just what it looks like when you pull it off. It's completely different. So it can be intimidating sometime. But you do have that thumbnail there you can look at for reference and everything you want to do for shading and for rendering. But now at this point, it's on your paper. And now you just go into rendering. That's really all you got to do. And that's what saves the time. You do all that work on the small scale, blow it up, trace it out, and boom, now you're in the rendering stage. And that's why I think that's why a lot of people like this process that do this.
Yeah, yeah. I used to love doing it.
I've done it for comic pages, and I've done it for like pinups or covers as well. Back in the day when I was working on Reaper Destroyer, back in the mid-2000s, Okwapo said I actually use the process every now and again, and I have a light box that can fit a 13x18. Nice.
Yeah,
I do the same thing. Like every once in a while, I will do something similar to this, especially if I'm like struggling on something. I might draw it smaller and then blow it up to kind of help figure out what the hell I'm doing.
You know, that's fun though, because you're not resting on your laurels. You're kind of going, taking a step, not a step back, but it's kind of like going to what you knew originally, you know, or just for shits and giggles. It's just fun.
Yeah.
Cause you know, drawing by yourself all these hours, it's lonely and it can be fucking boring being by yourself.
Yeah.
So it's all about entertaining yourself. Look at his pullouts.
Yes.
Like my pullout game is tight, but this guy is a fucking legend.
So this was the first time too that I started learning about why you pull out from shadows, why you render like this, why you crosshatch. And this was a big eye opener for me. And I still had more to learn after this, but it was really interesting to finally understand why artists drew the lines that they drew. In the places where they drew them. You know, before I was just kind of trying to copy and mimic stuff, and I had no idea what I was doing, just throwing stuff down that looked natural. And then it would look wrong. But after watching this, I was like, oh, okay, I get it. That makes sense. It makes total sense.
It's like when artists give advice, like, don't do what they're doing just because it's doing it. They're doing it. I'm like, why? You're doing it. Like, I'm going to fucking mimic you. Like, why are you telling me not to?
You know? Like, I'm still going to do it. Apex Comics says, does Stephen Platt increase the image on a photocopy machine and place it on a board to trace it over? Back in the day, that's what you do. You just take it to a photocopy, and a lot of copiers can increase it or decrease things to different sizes. And there's a lot of times a setting for 11x17. You just boom, hit it 11x17, and it prints it out. There it is. The image is all big. Now all you have to do is put it right on your light box, and you're good to go. Let me pause this because we do have a $5 super chat from El Guapo. Our man says, "Love you guys. Keep it." I was listening in background as I drew. Another $5. Thank you, brother. Says, oh, wait, did you do that twice?
Well, thank you. Te quiero mucho.
Oh, man. Let me, I'll see. I don't know if I can, I'll figure out if I can get that money back for you, man. But you didn't need to send that twice.
The
same one if it went through. But we appreciate you. So let's see. Where, why don't you do it? Dr. Fishy.
Dr. Fishy! No!
You see, thank you, brother. We appreciate you very, very much.
Yeah, very cool.
All right, jump back in here. My buddy has 11 kids. Weak pullout game. Yeah, no shit.
Damn, that guy likes to fuck.
That's no pullout game.
Yeah, shout out to him.
He's like, that's cool. I'm going to live with the consequences. All good. Yeah, it's all good, baby. Let's see.
See him doing
Oh, somebody's dog's going crazy.
Yeah, Mark's.
Drawn Sword Graphics is a 20C copy at the library then.
20 cents?
20 cents a copy. I got you. Nice. Ain't bad. Yeah. What was cool is when I was doing this back in the day, I always worked at a place with an office, and I'd always slip up there like around lunchtime or something, and I would use their copies. And some of the people, I mean, they knew I was trying to get into comics, and they didn't care. They'd let me use the copier for free.
Just let me live my dream.
Yeah, I was like, let me just, you know, help me out. Dude, help me out. Rest in peace, Dr. Fishy. That's right. Guy just marinated now. Never even thought of pulling that. That's what I was going to say. Yeah, strong fertile game. Yes.
There you go.
Yes. Not only was it just like the pullouts and the renders and the feathering and the cross hatching with this, but I became better and knew more about why you did lighting sources and why you shaded things certain ways. And one of my favorite lighting directions is probably still from the top down, or maybe from top down across a little bit. You don't really have to go crazy dynamic. I mean, a lot of people, some people do like two different lighting sources, or sometimes three different lighting sources. You don't really you don't really have to do that. You can if you want to. It's not required. You can still make something look really awesome with just one lighting or one light source. Yeah, look at that midsection though.
Yeah, that's powerful.
And that's again, a lot of people will say that he kind of adopted some of the stuff from what he saw Finch doing, because if you look at the two styles, especially around this time, very similar. But if you just look at the sharp shadows and just it's how it's helped just by those lines being pulled out ever so slightly, you know, just gives a little bit of depth and a 3D aspect to the roundness of the muscles.
Yeah, he's just killing it. I wish he drew like this again.
Oh, me too, man. I miss this style. Like, obviously, I miss his 90s style, but his like Soul Saga style as well was just so awesome.
Yeah,
which was kind of like around this era. crap, I forgot what I was gonna say. Oh, we got God. Eric Weathers in the house. Hail, brother. Battle Brick Road 2 is live now. Live now on his own site, doing very well. Was about 20 grand, I think.
God bless.
He's already up to on that. So absolutely killing it. We're going to have him on Odd and Stuff coming up. I think, I forgot what date I shout out to him. 13th, I think, September 13th. So nice. Looking forward to that, getting him back on the show. Also, a very talented letterer as well, doing my book and Sean's book and everybody's book.
Everybody getting laid right now.
Eric July's Ison books. So he's all over the place. He's killing it.
Yeah,
Devin Vo in the house.
Hail.
Good to see you. Thanks for being here, guys. Okay. If you haven't yet, guys, please hit the like button. Hit the bellification so that you can see every time we go live and bring you amazing art like this. Shout out to the six people watching over on Rumble. You guys absolutely are awesome over there. Appreciate you guys joining us tonight. We are watching the Stephen Platt Gnomon DVD.
Yeah,
I don't know how to pronounce it, but it's Gnomon. DVD from like 2000 and I don't know, 4, 5, 6, something like that. Right around.
I think they're
right
still for sale. There's a bunch of great ones. Finch has a bunch.
Yeah, Finch has one. I was thinking about looking at Finch's too at some point, because I have Finch's and I got Platt's, obviously. Look at the line work there on his arm.
Wait, do you have the horse one or the one where he does the figures, heads, or hands and feet? Because there's a bunch.
Oh no, I got the horse one. I didn't realize he did two of them.
Yeah, well, there's a bunch. I got them broken up legally. So maybe we could do those.
Well, I know you can find a lot of them online now.
Yes, they're misworded though, just for a copyright strike. Like it's out of nowhere. It's
I mean, you can buy like the actual Gnomon or whatever site is still available, and you can still buy the file or subscribe to the file. What I love about this technique, guys, right here is the thick to thins and how he builds it.
Yeah.
You know, that's something I never understood as a kid. So, like, when I would see this technique done in a comic book and then I would go to do it myself, I would never do the thick to thin. I'd just pull the lines and they never looked the same, right? It would always look odd. You know, I never understood why. Watching this DVD for the first time, I was like, oh, well, duh.
Yeah.
You know, you're building the line and you're going back to the base and you're thickening it out, you know, and you're just rendering. It's part of rendering, you know?
It's a very Geiger-esque to his fade-outs as well.
Yeah, I love it. Oh. Yeah, just ever so slightly right there, just boom, building it out of the blacks. gradually just building it out of the blacks there. When you pull out, it makes so much sense. You know, it looks so good. Like, this style is awesome. It's one of the reasons why I draw in a similar style. Platt for the longest time was my main influence. Like, when I got I got this DVD, I was heavy into Platt, and I realized this DVD was out there, and I went out and got it, and it changed my life. And I was just very Platt-esque in my style until I got into Silvestri and kind of took it in a different direction.
I love the dents and the dings that he does. The technique, one of the best of him and Finch. So cool. Oh yeah,
one of the best at doing that armor. Good. Yes, hail the Core 20. Absolutely in the house. Finch and Platt were influencing each other for a while when they were both young guns. Yeah, and I think it was more so that Finch was influencing Platt.
Yeah, that's confirmed.
Yeah, that's come from a lot of sources, including Frege.
Yeah,
who we all trust in.
Platt had Finch and Bastard all over his studio.
So. Yeah, Sheldon is saying for Eric Weathers, you get letters, you get letters, you get letters.
Goddamn dogs.
Eric's saying, I love the rendering style here. Yeah, this is, yeah. To me, this is comic book art. And, you know, people can argue back and forth what they specifically like about comic book art. But when I think about comic book art, I think of this, the heavy rendered line work, shading, shadow, lighting.
Of the draping of the cape, of the cloth, I should say. Look at that.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I mean, look at the detail, too. I love just extra lines on the armor. You don't need to do all of it, right?
No.
But it just looks good.
Yeah, you know?
It takes a little bit of time, for sure. It takes a little bit of time, but just fucking looks awesome. We got Chimera in the house. Hail.
What's up, brother? Good to see you.
And also, one of our favorites, member of the channel, Shanny's in the house, dropping the ducks.
Duck. Goose.
Yes. Oh, speaking of which, we got a member for 4 months. Member chat with the ducks. And you know what? Because you're here and we love you so much.
Kick him the dick.
Here you go.
Hello, Eugenia.
Jimmy King.
Oh!
You are a bastard.
Yeah!
Let me help you up.
I guess I deserve that.
Oh, I just had to kick you in the diddly again.
It's kicking the diddly one more time again. And Shanny's coming through with an actual $5 super chest. And love y'all. Love you.
We love you.
Love you. Well, you know what? Because Kayla's not here, let's do, we'll do the Kayla for you.
So that I may talk. Squirrel! My master is good.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And everybody drop those ducks in the chat. Duck Bacon's got it. Look at the ducks going. Let's go. We know the thing. I want to see the ducks in the chat, everybody. Let's go. Here we go to Weathered Armor. Right? Just kind of adding a little bit more detail, a little bit more grit texture to what he's doing. This changed, again, all these little lines changed my life at 23, 22. I don't know how old I was at the time.
How old are you now?
41.
You're old.
Fucking old, man. Fucking old. Still good looking, though. That's a fact. It's a fact, Jack. Chimera says, dude, from Dr. Doolittle. Which one?
I guess the one that got kicked in the dick.
Was he from Dr. Doolittle? We got Phil Diaz in the house. Hey, guys. Hey to you,
Lobo,
brother.
Lobo, Lobo.
Lost Pages 3, still going strong, kicking ass. Everybody go check that out.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing some updates, some awesome art getting out there. Hell,
I'm spreading a rumor that we're going to try to get Phil out to Ocean City Comic Con in December.
I like that.
So let's start that. Everybody, tell Phil he needs to come to Ocean City, Maryland. Great, great one-day show, family show. Off-season by the beach, good times. Ocean City Comic Con.
Yeah, I was disappointed I couldn't make it out to Fan Expo this year because I really enjoyed hanging out with Phil and Brandon and a bunch of the other guys last year at Fan Expo. But next year, we're going to work on something, try to get that
nice.
Out. Phil is saying, spread it like the clap, baby.
There we go. All right.
Let's go. So the detail, even the small little face within this armor, and I can't remember the exact story with this character, but he's got like a bunch of different faces that talk.
It just looks cool. Yeah.
Yeah, it just looked awesome, you know?
Yeah.
Well, okay, so let me look. Let me pause. Pause.
Look at Stripe.
Oh, damn it. Damn it. Okay, I was about where I was at.
Yeah.
All right, oh, close to where I was at. I just wanted to show the shading when we get up to the arm here. Just the subtle, there we go. Subtle shading, right? Underneath the armor, you can't see where I'm pointing, but underneath the armor where the armpit is and just kind of going over the shoulder, you know, just subtle, but it just brings the figure out so much, gives it depth, gives it meaning, gives it soul. People.
Saga.
Yeah. Sodomy. What?
What?
Oh, sorry. It gives it soul saga is what it gives it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Plug it.
Plugged it.
And he's just going to town. Like, again, it's almost like off the cuff right now.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's why this is just the fun part. You know, like, again, when you know exactly what you're doing, and granted, it's going to be different, right? Like, different stages of your career of what you know how to do and how you know how to render. But obviously, he's like at a master class at this point in his art career, so you can kind of just go in, you know exactly what you're doing, and basically a lot of this stuff is probably right off the cuff, instinctual, just kind of flowing as it goes, as you're building these shapes, as you're building the armor. So, I mean, what was interesting about adopting this style when I did, I was able to do a little bit more of that because you rendered so much on the small scale that when you got to the bigger scale, the information was there, the line work was there, and it allowed you just to kind of get in and start rendering. You know, and if you know what you're doing, you just boom, you go to town.
Yeah,
I still enjoy my process, how I do now, which is go right to the board and just keep the energy. It's just what I'm comfortable with right now, and it works. But just watching this DVD, and it's the first time I've seen this in years. But just kind of remembering back, like how much it changed my life as an artist, and you know, allowed me to just branch out and just have an understanding. Like it's just. It's very cool to see this again.
And, you know, a lot of guys can't do this. Like, they make it stiff and lifeless. Right. Probably just because they don't do the line weight variation.
True.
They don't follow the proper process of doing a light gesture of the sketch of the figure. And that's probably why.
And that's one thing. Like, if you guys look for this DVD, whether you try to buy it, find it online, watch it. He's got commentary, and the commentary is very helpful too, because he's explaining stuff like line weights and why he's shading, like all this other stuff. So I'm not playing the commentary right now because we're trying to keep from YouTube yanking this while we're live, because I just don't know with the copyrights. And by the way, if we do disappear, just hit rest in peace in the chat and we'll know that we're offline, and we'll pull this down and hang out till they put us back on. But right now it seems to be going pretty good. Fingers crossed.
And look at that cool, intricate design that he's doing on her wristband.
Oh, yeah.
Still following suit to the character the big dude character.
There is a lot of design elements that I took from Platt during this period of time. And I still have it within my work today. Just kind of the overlapping, twisting, turning of some of the stuff. And I don't know if that's kind of like manga influence or whatever that he might have been into at the time. Because Soul Saga was a very manga feel to it. That fantasy.
Record of Lotus War. Yeah, for sure.
When is your guys' Gnome and Shop videos going to be released? Hopefully soon.
Yeah. 2 weeks on Thursday.
Yeah, there you go. Hmm. I don't know. That might be interesting. So I've got a store I'm going to be opening up.
Plug it.
I got a store I'm going to be opening up here pretty soon where you can get original art, you can get commissions, you can buy a lot of the ash cans I still have left over from the Reaper Destroyer ash cans. Mm. It will be the site that I eventually will do campaigning from going forward with issue 2 once we get issue 1 out into the hands of all the backers. But yeah, maybe that's something I consider.
You know? How's that going?
What, Reaper Destroyer?
Yeah, plug it.
Going very good. Plug in Reaper Destroyer. All right, over 30 pages have been colored.
What?
Of the main book, most of the Vanessa story and half of the Apophis story is colored for the supplemental book. I've got 2 more pages to draw of the 44 pages of the book. So we are damn close to getting this thing done. I am bringing the campaign down at the end of September. That's an official date. It's not an official date yet. It's an official time. How about that? It's an official time, not an exact date yet. I'll do it like on a weekend or something, you know. But I'm going to bring it down because I want to have a cutoff date. I want to be done. I want to move on to getting, you know, process of fulfillment. Even if we're not going to print at that moment, I want to bring it down just so people can tell that, boom, we're moving in that direction. So be on the lookout for that. You guys got another month to back Reaper Destroyer before we bring it down. We'll do a big push at the end.
See, he's so close to 70K.
I would love to try to get it to 70K. Yeah. Yep, we're a little over 65 right now. If we could get it to 70, I think that would be awesome. We're at 1,080 backers, I think, right now. I would love to get to 1,100 backers at least.
Selfishly, you know what that means, folks. The Joe Carver Type 1 variant cover is coming.
Yes.
Once Joe finishes Reaper Destroyer, respectfully.
Yes, sir. Yes, that sir. Awesome. That's the next priority.
It doesn't suck.
My commission list will be opening. I'm going to take a commission list and try to do a planned out year commission. So people looking for covers, that's going to have to be more of like a rush thing. We can talk about it. But if somebody wants work from me, I'm going to plan out something where you can get on a list. And we'll talk a lot about this later. But the cool thing about the shop is that it allows the backer or the person getting a commission to break up the commission over a period of 4 months to 12 months. So you can buy a commission and you can pay for it as you go. You know, I'm going to try to create a list where I maybe take like 12 and I call it good for the year and we just work on it. But you can do 11 by 17s or 9 by 12s. There's going to be lots of options, but we're going to launch that store probably not too long after we close the Reaper Destroyer campaign. So be on the lookout. I'm going to gradually kind of advertise. I'll be showing it off a little bit, just kind of the behind the scenes workings of it as we're going, go over some prices and everything. It'd be cool. I think you guys will dig it.
Yeah.
And anything on that store is stuff you can get at that moment, except for the commissions. That's the only thing you have to wait for, because obviously that's something that you'll have to work on. But we're going to have original art, prints, all that kind of stuff, and it's going to be ready to go. You buy it, we ship it out. So it's pretty cool. I'm excited about it.
Doesn't it look like there's like a cool face like on the costume, like from her titties to the chest?
Dude.
Like a really like a lot of face.
Yeah.
You know?
It's actually kind of funny when you look at a midsection, the tits of a figure, and you're just looking at it. Sometimes it can look like a character. I drew this picture, and I'm not gonna tell you what picture it is because I don't want people to see it like this. But one day I was looking at it, I was like, it looked like Roger from American Dad, because he had the tits, and then like the belly button looked like his mouth.
Which one's Roger?
The alien.
Oh, well,
I was just like, I'm not telling anybody that. I'm not telling anybody. Look who we got in the chat. What? Absolute legend, Art T-Bear.
Inca extraordinaire.
Man, this guy draws fast. Yes.
Yeah.
This is sped up on sped up. I think the DVD was originally 2 hours long, and that was a sped up DVD, and I sped it up even faster to make it about an hour long.
He must have had some of that leftover extreme cocaine that they had in the studio. AR? I've heard stories.
We'll have to get Art back on and tell us about it. Tell us about it. He was there.
Yeah.
He witnessed the
pioneer. Yeah.
He knows what's up.
Most of the inkers these days owe their careers to that gentleman.
Absolutely. Everybody go check out Black and White Back It.
Mm-hmm.
That book looks like it's coming along very nicely. And Pontificators, when they're going, was it Wednesdays at 8 they usually do? When they're rolling?
Rolling.
Yeah, just I really enjoy the style. Obviously, this is for Soul Saga at the time, characters that were in Soul Saga. Mm-hmm. So it's got that, like you said, was it the Lotus War?
The Wreck of the Lotus War?
Yeah. So it's got that kind of
battle chasers.
Yeah, that fantasy, but also high-tech aspect to the armor. So it just allows some really fun designs within the suits and the outfits and all that stuff. Lots of line work, lots of fun for an artist, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe not for an inker, I don't know. Because Weems, I think, inked this, right? No, that was the Finch.
No, that was the Finch. That was the horse,
But that was detailed as shit as well.
Yeah.
So
I don't know if I have that.
No, I got to get that one. I would like to get that one. because we all know Weems is one of my favorite guys. I'd love to watch.
Don't be selfish. One of mine as well. Yeah, sorry. Selfish Stanley.
Speaking of people making stuff, I would love to see Art make a video like this, regardless of if it was drawing or if it was inking.
Get that bloopy lines.
That would be
fun. Oh my god. I get really artistically hard when I see Art's bloopy lines from the 90s. Yes. It's like, why can't everybody else do this?
Let's all go to the mountains. The powder is fine. Yes. Mountains of cocaine is what they say. It's what the cool kids say. Is that what the cool kids say? That's what they might say. Yeah. I'm cool. That's what they say.
Eh.
I am.
She's got a neck brace on. Looks like she broke her neck.
Yeah, I like it. Designs of armor and clothing and outfits and all that kind of stuff. What I love about the fantasy, and really fantasy is in comics, right? But you can just, what I love about comics is the unrealistic stuff. These giant capes, these folds, you know, like this armor and stuff. Like that's comics to me. That's exciting. The fact that some people would dog on this kind of stuff or be like, oh, it doesn't look, it's not realistic, you know, blah, blah, blah.
It doesn't look boring.
Yeah, right, exactly. Yeah, like it doesn't look boring. It looks fucking awesome, man.
Yeah.
Look at this stuff. We got?
Oh, wow.
David Brohawk Williams is in the house.
Good to see you.
Hail, brother. Good to see you. What a legend. I'm new here. Who are we watching? We were watching Stephen Platt's DVD. This was the Gnome, G-mon, Gnomon series. From the early 2000s. David, this was, I've said this a couple times, but for people that are just joining us now, by the way, 22 people in the chat, and we have 3 over on Rumble. Guys, please hit the like wherever you're at. Smash that like. Hit the notifications for the notifications so you get a chance to see every time we go live and look at awesome art like this. This was a DVD that really projected my knowledge of how to draw, for one, and then a step up in ability. Because visually, for the first time, I was actually seeing how lines were produced by comic book artists instead of studying lines by myself and then trying to figure out why they did what they did. And then just, you know, not having the grasp on it. So, like, this DVD was great. And this was one of the first times I got to see an artist draw, period. Like, they didn't have YouTube back then. You know, now you can just jump into YouTube and you got Jim Lee all over the place. Sylvester's drawing, Liefeld, you know, Ryan Benjamin, like, all these guys. You can find all these comics, Philip Tan, all these artists drawing on YouTube. And you can really just kind of study and watch artists draw. This was the very first time that I got to see one of my favorite artists draw at the time. And it really did change my... It changed my life when it came to comic book art and knowledge. 100%. And it just looked fun. I remember going from the style I had to watching this DVD and then going into a style where I was just like, all of a sudden, I was about the detail. And like, granted, sometimes detail can get overwhelming. Like, sometimes it's not needed, right? You know, like, you can go overboard with detail. Like, I get in the argument with people about that sometimes. Like, you can over-render, yes. You can over-render, you can overdo this, for sure. But if you do it right, and you do it with a purpose, one, it's just fun as hell as an artist. And two, it can just look beautiful. I mean, this piece absolutely looks gorgeous.
Yeah, I think right now in his stage of a career that he's drawing right now is more of a Mad and Finch.
Mm-hmm.
You know? With you know, prior Platt. I wish he stuck to this.
Yeah, me too. Like, and we said this earlier, like, this is one of my favorite eras of Stephen Platt drawing. And the Soul Saga thing was absolutely awesome. Like, I really enjoyed that series. It's too bad it ended on, what, 5?
6.
6 was the last issue.
But that was a French edition.
Yeah. And I actually got that.
He didn't want to do that. Oh, cool. All right, cool.
I had to go on eBay, but I ended up getting that.
Yeah.
I didn't even know it existed until, like, a couple years ago.
Yeah.
We got $4.99 from a member of the channel, Sheldon Martin, said, when in doubt, over-render. I like
facts.
That. I'll take it. I'll take that. You get it, Dr. Fishy.
Dr. Fishy! No!
Thank you, brother. Appreciate you. Tell that dog to come on into the stream or shut the hell up.
They're not my dogs. I can't hit them. I would love to beat the crap out of them. Every fucking day. I'm sorry. I can't do anything. They're not my dogs.
Overdue Outlaw Style. only have digital six. Oh, okay. I got you.
Cool.
Maybe that's what it was. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's just digital. Maybe I got it on Comixology. Now that I think about it. Good call. Call me out there, Darmex. You're probably right. It was just the digital, not the physical. Good call, man. Keep me honest around here. I like it. Dude, but I have to go soon.
Ooh.
Oh, I like this too. I live by this as well. When in doubt, black it out. It's faster. Hollywood. I feel you. Trust me, I do that as well. Especially if I'm running like low on time or I'm trying to get through a piece. I will start going to a little bit more heavy blacks and heavier shadows for sure.
Bunch of Lizzos for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, I think we're actually, this is getting close. I think we're almost done with this DVD.
Wow.
Yeah, it's about three quarters of the way done.
And if you see how when he was doing the transfer, his pencil lead wasn't as sharpened and crisp because he still just wanted to keep the energy and the flow.
Good call.
And then as he went in and built his shapes, his shadows, his form, and his rendering is when he tightened it up and made it crisper just for that detail.
I think also use like a lighter lead, right, for the transfer, and then a heavier lead when you're doing the renders.
Yeah.
And I always get kind of confused, different leads that some of these artists draw, because everyone uses different stuff. And you got the two H's, the two, the HBs, and friggin', I don't know.
Then people use, is it F, which is dark as shit. Yeah, that is, that's hard. That's smeary. You know, Kari Randolph uses that.
That's the thing. The thing that drives me insane is I don't like smearing. Even if you wear a glove, you still smudge it. It just pisses me off as an artist that likes a little cleaner work. And smudging, it makes things look ugly. Even though it might not look it once you do a scan and adjust it a little bit. Yeah. But just in the original piece, like I use when I draw, I think I use a 2H.
Oh, most 2H, part. Yep.
And that's really,
number two pencil, which is HB, I believe.
Yeah, I use the HB as well. Like, and that's when I'm not inking. When I'm inking, I'll just lightly use whatever with a really dull lead tip. Mm-hmm. And then just go in and start rendering it with whatever I'm rendering with. Right now, I'm using the Faber-Castells, I really dig. But Copics and the Microns work as well. It's whatever I'm in. I got so many fucking pens. And I'm actually Crow Quill, too. I'm getting a little bit better. A little bit better at the traditional inks as well. The great thing about art, never stop learning new tips or new things. Thanks for sharing. Hell yeah. Well, thank you for being here. We got to get you on the show sometime, man.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love to have you on and talk. It'd be fun. Fun that the DWJ draws with a 2B.
Or not 2B?
Not 2B. 2B or not 2B?
That is the question.
That'd be cool. Yeah, I mean, 2B, I think. Oh, maybe it is 2B. 2B, 2B. I get a look. Like, I get so burnt out on the actual. I'm a horrible artist when it comes to, what do you do? What do you use? I'm like, I can't remember.
What's in front of me?
Like, it's, yeah. I was like, I got inventory of it. I just grab it. I forgot what it is. You know what? This is actually something I forgot that he did.
Putting that in on the fly?
Yeah. I forgot about that. Yeah, I remember the two characters mainly, but I forgot about this character. Does he pencil this type for himself to ink? If so, that's insane. I don't think so. With Soul Saga, he was working with Bat, I think, on some of the books. And he might have had other inkers as well. This specifically was just for this tutorial, I guess, if you want to call it that.
Yeah.
For this Gnomon series. So I don't know if this even ever got inked, to be honest with you. But when he was doing Soul Saga, I think Bat was inking him. So he just drew.
Maybe Weems.
Yeah, it might have been Weems too. I can't remember. I have to look up again. But yeah, he just draws this tight. I doubt he would go back and ink it this tight. I mean, like, that's a lot of work. Do the same thing over again. The first time would be fun. The second time would be that would be a chore. But honestly, when you're doing this tight, you could probably just go right to colors too, honestly.
Yeah, just clean up and just do some adjustments in tone and you're there.
Damn.
Yeah.
Hell yeah. I also like plat drawing profit.
So do we all.
If you like that, go back in our archives. We did an Appreciating Comic Book Art Live series where we looked at a lot of Stephen Platt's work, specifically Prophet and Soul Saga. I think Malin might have been on for that show.
Was he on for the Spider-Man one or the Moon Knight? The Moon Knight stuff?
Oh, we did Moon Knight too. Yep.
Yeah.
I just kind of covered a little bit of his career going from Marvel to Image to his own stuff. So, but yeah, go back in the archives and check that out. Yeah, you don't remember that?
We did a bunch. No, I remember doing them. We've done so many shows. It's just like, was it a one centric one or was it, just a book?
No, it was books. It was multiple. Yeah, we did a ton. We did the Moon Knight. We did the Prophets. We did Soul Saga. We did the relaunch of Prophet.
Great book.
Beautiful relaunch of Prophet 1 with the holochrome cover.
Yeah.
With Liquid doing the colors. Yeah. Okay, so the 2B smears. That's right. That's what it is. So I use the H's. I use the HB and I use the 2H, I think. So I think I stay away from the 2Bs. I stayed away from anything that smeared too much because it just, my OCD is too, like, I'll spend so much time cleaning up with eraser and it's just waste of time because I'm just, for vanity wise, trying to make it look pretty. You know?
I think that's why I really love doing digital, because I'm not worried about smearing the page, because I'm like you, like, it's not pristine, it's not crisp, like the OCD Virgo in me, like, it just fucking goes crazy. It's wild. But I'm working on me.
I construct in the 2H. Yeah, I think that's what I do too. Mm-hmm. I'd have to look at my drawer here with all my lead that's in there, my inventory, my stock of lead, but I'm pretty sure that's what it is, 2H. Inkers of Soul Saga were Sal Regla, Joe Weems, and Marlo Elquiza. Okay, thank you.
Nice.
For some reason, I thought, did Bat do some covers? For some reason, I thought Bat was on there too. But yeah, Weems for sure. Marlo. Yeah. Speaking of which, two of those three guys do inking in my book, Reaper Destroyer, in InDemand now on Indiegogo, ending September, let's just say 30th for right now.
Okay.
It was very fun working with a lot of those guys. And I almost had Sal on the book as well. I had him pegged to do a few pages. He wasn't able to hit deadline and ran out of time, but he might do some work. No, but he might do some work on issue 2 because I really enjoy Sal. Sal's another guy we got to get back on the show. He's an awesome dude. Very fun to talk to.
I haven't met him yet.
Marlo is a sweetheart of a man. Really enjoy talking with him. Learned a lot. Yeah, asked him a bunch of stuff about inking, but he was awesome. Did a great job on the book as well. Digital is great. It will always end up digital in the end. You got to scan those pages for color, etc.
Facts.
Truth.
I always thought this sword looked kind of like a snail.
It does kind of look like a snail. Yeah. Now you mention
it. But that's cool. Like you could take shapes from anywhere and interpret it. Like there was a, if you guys are in Star Wars Episode 3, they were making General Grievous. Warren Fu, or Wu, or whatever. Anyway. He created one of the droids when he was just taking a piss, washing his hands in the bathroom, and like a spray bottle. He looked down at it and he saw a cool face. So one of the droids in there is from, I'm just looking at the bottom of the spray bottle. I was like, oh my God, that blew my mind of how to create.
Hell yeah. You can take inspiration, design inspiration from anything. That's awesome. Mm-hmm. Like if you have a mind for it, you know?
Yeah.
Sheldon Martin said, Brohawk is a master. Cool to hear he is still a student as well. Absolutely. And that's
never stop learning.
I was just going to say, yeah, like when the words of wisdom and truth, you know, as an artist, you never stop learning.
And if you think you're done, call it quits.
Yeah.
Call it quits. Like,
yeah. Check your ego.
Yeah.
I'm still always trying to learn. You know, I've taken leaps and bounds over the last year.
Some might brag about it.
Yeah, some might brag about it, but not me. But a lot of it is just, you know, continual studying and continual working on stuff. Like I've been working more on my inking lately than I have on my drawing because I wanted to do more inking. So I started really studying inkers and stuff. You know, I still got a little ways to go, but I really enjoy what I'm doing. But that's just something I'm continuing to learn, you know? It's only gonna make me better in the end.
Yeah, me too. What you said.
Yeah.
Spread that rumor.
Look at that gun.
Cool guns. You
know, somebody posted something on, I think it was Facebook. It was a Rob Liefeld. No, it wasn't Liefeld. It was somebody. Anyway, it was a drawing with a gun. That's all I remember. Mm-hmm. It was like one of those futuristic guns, right? You know? And maybe it was on that the Wildstorm Universe page, and somebody had to make a comment about the gun, you know. And I'm just like, I couldn't help myself. I had to jump in. I was just like,
"What'd you say? What would you
do? You do realize that, like, this is, it's all fantasy. Like, the gun's not drawn to be realistic. It's drawn to be like, think of anything you might see in Star Wars or friggin', you know, any of those sci-fi, sci-fi shows. That those guns don't look realistic. That's what this is. This is modern day fantasy, sci-fi fantasy." And she said something about, like, "Well, why does the gun have wings?"
Of course, it was like, a woman.
Not wings. It's clips. Yeah. It's clips. No. It's cool clips, man. Come on.
Of course, it was a female giving her opinion.
It was a chick too. I was like, "Yeah, get the hell out of here, man."
Yeah, I bet she's an editor, Kayla.
By the way, shout out to Kayla. We love you, darling.
Yep.
I hope you're getting the rest that you were looking for. We will see you back here next Tuesday.
For Nipplegate Part 2.
Nipplegate Part 2, which we will let her explain.
Yeah.
Jeremy Birch just became a member. Thank you, brother. Appreciate it. Welcome to the Superior Court. By the way, anybody that is a member to this channel, you can go on to the community section and you can see behind the scenes looks at the making of Reaper Destroyer. I put on page layouts, progressions, finish pages, scans, all that kind of stuff. You get to see it before anybody else gets to see it, and there are some things that you see that nobody else sees until the book gets printed.
I get to slap in my DMs. I will give you half price. I will give you half price on Joe's Supreme Court. Slide my DMs and I'll fucking
Superior Court.
Whatever.
Superior Court.
Man. And we're going to jail.
David said, "Sadly, I don't know how to use Photoshop to this very day." Oh,
I can
interesting.
Do it for you.
Try Clip,
very,
man.
Very simple. Yeah, very simple. Very simple. We would love to have you on, and we could show you how to do it. Very simple.
Absolutely. If David, if we, I think we're friends on the Twitters, on the X's, whatever it's called. If not,
slipping our DMs.
Yeah, I'm gonna friend request you. And accept it so I can send you a DM. I don't know if you've got
it's
the
threatening.
Yeah, like, just do it. All right,
just do it, David.
Just freaking do it, man.
Why didn't you do it already?
Let me see if I can find you on here.
It's cool that he's carving out the forms of everything, of these characters he added on the fly.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
That, yeah, that was awesome because we saw all the thumbnail work where he had all the tight thumbnails, and now he's just throwing stuff in. So it's kind of a combination of the thumbnails to blow up to big, and then also going right to the board, keeping that energy and working the actual picture out. We got Shanny for $2 says, "Craving another diddly kick." I like it. Well, your wish.
Don't throw me the good time.
Is our command.
$15, little man. Put that shit in my hand. If that money doesn't show, then you owe me.
Was the wrong one.
Hello, Eugenia.
I'm the king.
Oh!
You are a bastard.
Yeah!
Let me help you up.
I guess I deserve that.
Oh, I just had to kick you in the diddly again.
One more time again in the diddly. Thank you, Shanny, for the $2 with the duck. Drop the ducks in the chat, everybody. I want to see the ducks. Flood the ducks in the chat. Let's go. Let's go.
No geese. Ducks.
Yes. Ouch. Yes. Damn right. We got MB Bonner in the house. Ahoy, guys. Ahoy to you.
Hola.
Good to see you, man. Thank you for being here. By the way, 25 people in the chat. I think we got three watching over on Rumble. Please hit the like button. Subscribe. Hit the bell notification so you get a notification every time that we go live. You can see awesome art like this every Tuesday. Do it.
And more importantly, back type one on Indiegogo. Live right now.
That's right.
Your show. Let's do this.
I love that it was the wrong for it was the one right above it. And like I'm like, wait a minute, this is not right. The design on the this design right here. So Reaper Destroyer, if you ever look at his gauntlets, people think that I got the gauntlet design from the darkness, which the darkness was an influence. But designs like this were an influence too. Just how the armor kind of bleeds up into the costume of the arm.
Yeah.
Absolutely love that.
Don't you hate that when somebody's like, "You got that from that"? No, I didn't.
Right.
Maybe like, you did. Oh, okay. All right. You're right, dickhead.
There you go. Duck Bacon dropping those ducks. Appreciate you guys. Chat, you guys are awesome as usual. We love you all. Thank you for being here.
ooh, I love this sword. It's like a half cut off donut.
Yeah, and again, it's just kind of designing some of the stuff on the fly. I like the freedom in that. A lot of my characters, so I'm very honest when it comes to my approach to character design. A lot of times I design a character on the fly, you know, unless there's a specific, you know, thing that I'm doing, but like I design a character on the fly in the book and I what does it call for? What do I want to draw at the time? You know, and then I'll work it out. People are like, well, what are you going to do in the back or from this angle, you know what? When I get there, I will figure it out.
No, I'm not going to draw them from the back. How about them apples?
There's a lot of people that will hit me up sometimes that want to do fan art, and they're like, hey, can I get like the sheet, the what's it called? The
turnaround?
Sheet? Yeah. The model sheet of your characters. And I'm like, I have zero
model sheet. Well, what's the back of them? A cape?
Yeah, exactly.
Get the foggy joint cape so he didn't have to do that. Knock, knock.
Yeah. I'm like, so yeah, what's in the back? What's on the side? I don't know. I haven't drawn it yet, but when I get there, I'll let you know. Side of the cape. I'll design it when I get there.
Yeah.
But I like it like that because it just gives me the freedom to kind of, if I want to change something up, I'm not so. Now, granted, when I designed it the first time, that's what it would be going forward. It's not like he's going to look different every single time, except Reaper Destroyer. I specifically designed him that way so that I could tweak his armor because his armor is kind of live and moving aspect to it. So that's on its own. But some of the villains or whatnot, I got loose ideas. They're all in my head, man. Mm-hmm. I'll just go to the paper because it's a lot more fun than sitting down there. I remember Ethan Van Sciver, heard him say something that he doesn't draw just for the fuck of it, just to draw. Because it's like, why draw and waste time if you're not drawing something that's going to be making money, like pages?
Right.
And I was like, and I get that. I am a lot like that as well. I don't waste a lot of time with character designs, model sheets, all this stuff. You know, like I feel like my imagination is good enough. I got a good enough thought visual in my head that I can just go right to the board and bring it out. Just assume all Joe's characters are wearing assless chaps. Fuck yeah.
Yes, he's the cop from YMCA group. The village people.
Yeah.
I don't think that was the gay guy though, the group.
Weren't they all though?
No, actually like a few of them were straight, which I was like, wow.
Oh.
Yeah. But anyway, too strong. But this is an awesome character.
Good music. That's all I remember. YMCA, baby. Every time I hear that, I want to dance. You know what I'm saying?
That's a wedding song, man.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah, I love these the background design elements. It reminds me of like what Travis would do.
Yeah,
of course Mobius.
And a lot of it probably comes from like just manga style tech.
Yeah,
you know, tech designs. A lot of it's just shapes. You know, just fun shapes you put on top of each other,
mm-hmm.
and you make a form out of it. I mean, if you look at these hoses or whatever it is that you can, you know, just all the different little line work on the hoses. How's it function? What does it do? We don't know.
Who cares?
Looks cool, though.
Yeah.
Don't matter. Looks cool.
Yeah.
And Bivonner says tight pencils. Absolutely.
Like a tiger.
This is the era, like what, the mid-2000s, early 2000s, mid-2000s, when the very tight pencil craze was really starting to take off. Not that they didn't have tight pencils before, but a lot of the guys, I think, came after the like Image Founder generation. So like the Platts and Finches and the Turners and all them went through a phase where it's just like almost you're inking with your pencils.
And that's what it is. That's really what it is. Because, you know, I think it's so they can have more control of the final line art. Well, no, I don't think I know. Because why not? You know, because if not, they would have gotten an inker.
Plus, you know? This was also an era where the inking on blue line was starting to kind of pick up too.
Yeah.
Whereas back in the day, it was always right on the board.
Mm-hmm.
So pencilers would lose their original pencils, and then you share the piece with the inker when it comes to sale. And now you get to this era where you're doing extreme tight pencils, and then maybe the inker prints it out on blue line and inks it. So now you have your original pencils to sell. So you definitely wanted to make sure that it looked awesome so you could sell this for freaking like, you know, like $5,000 or whatever it might be, whatever the price was back then. But, you know, like a piece like this today by an artist like this, you know, going to be expensive, you know, they're going to make some money off it.
Yeah. So cool.
Again, just random design elements. And that's why I said this stuff like this just looks fun. You just do it.
this is like talking on the phone shit. You know, there's no thinking. You know, I'm sure there's some thinking, but like you don't have to be so in depth of worrying about the whole structure because it's already there.
And something like that, you're not worried about drawing again, so you can just kind of go all out and make it as crazy as you want to make it. And you're like, hey, this circle looks good here. Why is it here? I don't know. But let's make it a little bit more. Let's make it pop out a little bit more. Let's put some wear and tear on it. You know?
Why are you questioning me?
Yeah. Oh.
Why don't you do it?
Yeah, you don't like it. Do it yourself. No, yeah, this is if you guys get a chance, though, this is the Stephen Platt Noman series. I've got it. Oh, where's that?
I got it illegally, where Joe paid money.
Yeah, I paid money. Where the hell did I put it?
Sucker.
Hold on a second.
Here comes his sun, clouds, maybe a moon. Forget. I always thought this was a cool technique.
Oh, it's definitely, yeah, moon.
You know, just breaking it up. It's not all there, but it's there, kind of sense. Oh, man, such fun.
What am I doing with it?
It's a shame this guy doesn't do more shit like this. But he works in the movie field doing storyboards and probably conceptual design.
And that was the end of the video. Hold on a second. I got to step away from the desk. I'm going to grab and show you guys what the DVD looks like.
All right. Ask me questions. What's my favorite color? Favorite group? Type of pie? Favorite toppings on a pizza? I like barbecue chicken with some good sauce. I like Santana. I like light blue because my eyes.
Oh, yeah. What are we talking about?
Oh, just about me.
Honey. Oh, okay. So this is the DVD that we just watched. Comic Book Penciling with Stephen Platt. It's the Noman Workshop. Dude, this was expensive back in the day. It was like a $30 DVD.
Yeah.
In the early 2000s, mid-2000s. So like this was crazy expensive when we bought it. But so good. So informational. If you are an artist and you really are into the process of getting better and just knowing the tips and tricks of the trade, so to speak, and just great commentary. Again, we didn't get to hear the commentary because I was worried about YouTube pulling the live stream down, so I just kept it on mute. But the commentary is great, and he teaches you. He tells you why he's doing what he's doing, and that was very, very helpful for me as a young artist at the time.
Oh shit! He's got such a soft voice; it kind of throws you off because he draws such brawly characters, you know, grizzly, big, tough, macho dudes. He just kind of talks like this. Eventually, I got to get my setup. The internet connection isn't the best down here. We'll be moving upstairs in the next few months once things settle and change, but we'll get there. I got plans. I got ideas. You know what I'm saying, Joe?
I do. I know. We've been waiting for them for a couple years.
Yeah. Well, I'm Mexican. Mañana, mañana, mañana.
Johnson said, Splat teased he's doing some comic work on IG a few weeks back. Didn't say if interiors, though. I would love to see him get back and do some stuff. He's been out of the game for so long, not saying that he couldn't do it, but sometimes there's a little bit of rust, right? When you step away for so long. Some of the stuff I've seen him produce lately has been great, and then other stuff has been kind of like, you know.
That one Batman cover.
That Batman cover, like the head was messed up.
Yeah.
It was a weird looking, just, I don't know. But
improper choices of lighting, I think, really threw that off.
If he was ever to come back and do stuff like this, I would be 1,000% down, because he was one of my biggest influences at that time. And this is another one in the series. This is the David Finch one. And if you guys like this show, you liked kind of going over this, we can absolutely do the same thing with this DVD, mm-hmm. as long as they don't pull me down. But this is another very good DVD. And these are the only two of the five that they put out that I own.
Yeah,
but you can find these now. You can just type those in. You can find them. A lot of them, you can spend a little bit of money online and just stream them. Yeah, and download them.
Joe Benitez has one. David Finch has heads, hands, feet.
Benitez had one.
Yeah,
I'm gonna find that.
I got that. I'll just send it to Dropbox.
Oh shit! All right, yeah.
I sent it to you.
You did?
You probably have it.
All right, I'll have to look for it again.
Anyway, you know what? The one with Finch's, he does it on his channel. He does it on his stream. So everything on the Gnome ones, he has uploaded new, you know, or new tutorial videos for purchase on his site. So
Oh, gotcha.
You know, if you want to support the guy, give it a shot. All right, you going to bed? Art.
Love you, brother. Man. Thank you for tuning in. Got to get you back on the show, man. Yeah. You're really busy finishing up Black and White and doing a bunch of stuff, so maybe when the schedule gets a little bit less crazy and hectic, we'd love to get you back on, man.
Yeah, even when the schedule's fucking bananas.
Yeah, screw it, you know.
Take a break. Just,
yeah, take a break. Come on the show.
We miss you.
Same thing with David Williams. Love to get him on as well. Mm-hmm. That would be really fun. Love seeing you guys in the chat. Thank you so much. All right, so I teased that I was going to show you guys some progress. So when I was drawing, when I first started doing Reaper Destroyer, back in the Dizzy, this was 2006, I think I did this. And when I talk about character designs, it's kind of what I did with this guy. No model sheet. I just went right to the paper, and this was the original design when he had a trench coat instead of a cape. But this was kind of the style I was working in at the time. It was kind of like, you know, Jim Lee-ish, Rob Liefeld, you know, Tom McFarlane had a baby kind of thing. Those were my biggest influences at the time.
Oh, you know, again, how old is he?
These were my biggest influences at the time, style-wise. And again, I was doing things out of instinct and just trying to understand what I was seeing line work-wise on the page, and then just putting it out just naturally kind of going out. I didn't really know about light sources. I was just throwing dark areas where I saw my favorite artists throw dark areas, you know, like that's all I was doing. And got this DVD that we just watched, and I wish I could have found the next piece I did. I couldn't find that, but I found the second to next piece that I did, and just jump up in style. And that's this piece right here. And for some reason, I can't shrink this down. I don't know why I can't shrink it. Nope, that's it.
Go outside.
So I went from that style to a much more heavily rendered style. And I still had a lot to learn because I hadn't quite captured the rendering, hatching lines of pulling out of shadows and stuff, like thick to thins. You know, it's still very thin line work. But this was done off of a thumbnail sketch to blow up to 11 by 17 and then rendered it out. And this was very much influenced from the style that I saw, you know, and this was back in 2007. 11/25/2007.
Lord, oh, wow. Dragos. So that was after Wizard World.
Yeah. So that was right around the time I was making the turn. That was right about the time I met you was the time I was kind of making the turn from my old style to my new style.
Well, you're welcome.
Going very much more in a plat direction. But it was all because of the DVD. It really gave me progress in the right way. You could see I was kind of going in different ways, throwing different design elements in there and just having fun with stuff, you know, just doing things that didn't necessarily make sense, but didn't have to, you know. It was just, it was interesting, you know. And I've progressed now to fucking, 20 years later? Wait, no.
15, 16?
I was about to say, I'm not that old.
Geez. Well, you got in there.
15, 16 years later. And if you look at some of my... Where am I at here? Let me just share this.
Shizzle.
Let me share this. The shizzle.
Sharing time?
We'll plug anyway. We'll share and plug.
Why not?
By the way, look at that. 65,190. This is the big number right here. 1,080 backers. I'm so excited about that. Want to get it to 1,100. That would be awesome. Coming down September 30th, we're going to say that. The date might change, but end of September is what we're aiming for.
Yeah.
But just like doing that style and then jumping 15 years later. Now, this is inked by a legendary inker in Bat, but just increase in style, increase in knowledge over the years. You know, never stop learning. But a lot of this goes back and stems the biggest, that's Shelby Robertson, by the way. Mm. The biggest influences I had at the time and jump in knowledge and jump in style wise and understanding was from that DVD. And that comes through today. Even watching that DVD again kind of refreshed some thoughts that I kind of forgot. Because you forget things, you know, over time. You forget certain techniques, you know, as you're doing stuff. But a lot of that has led to what I'm doing now. And I'm extremely excited. I've taken all those influences, Platt, merging with some Sylvester and some Finch over the years, and just, you know, I'm very happy with the style I'm doing, the techniques I'm doing nowadays, and just, yeah, it's awesome. Drawing is awesome. If you got a passion for it,
do it.
Never stop.
Don't
never stop.
Believe it.
By the way, I have not made an update on this actual page. I need to do it. So I apologize for the backers who have not seen an actual update on here, because I do it so much on stream, I kind of forget. But over 30 pages of this book has been colored. 42 of the 44 pages have been drawn. The majority of it is inked. Half of the Apophis story is colored, and over, I would say just about half right now, the Vanessa story is colored as well. So this thing is kicking, guys, getting really close to being done, everything involved, and getting out, which is why I'm going to be bringing the campaign down at the end of September and hopefully getting ready to send to the printer and start getting this out to people. So the fulfillment process, which I'm sure is going to be long with over 1,000 backers. So be patient with me is all I ask. Because first time fulfilling, it's probably just going to be me and my wife. So I know everybody's going to want to get those books, especially when you start seeing the first wave of books go out. Just be patient. If you're not within the first wave, I'm working on it. I'll get it out hard once. I'll get it out hard. You know what I'm talking about. I'll get it out. I'll work hard to get it out once we get the book into fulfillment and we're actually doing it. So I know I got a couple people that volunteered to come help me out. If that's the case, I'll definitely take that.
Oh, wrong button.
Dude, you pulled a Kayla.
Yeah.
You didn't mute. You took the camera off and then you coughed. Very cool. Very cool. Yeah. Very cool. So yeah, be on the lookout for that, guys. Closing. I'd love to get the campaign to around 70K, and I'd love to get to 1,100 backers. But just a shout out to everybody that's backed the campaign. Everybody that will back the campaign, appreciate you guys and let me live this dream for the moment right now and getting this book out. And I can't wait for you guys to read it. It's the work of my life, and I absolutely it's been a pleasure to work on it. Jay Ryan says sometimes we just get complacent. And we need a reminder to get back on track, to start learning again. Yeah, sometimes that's exactly what it is. And sometimes, you know, again, like, yeah, complacency. I'll forget maybe a certain technique that I stopped doing for whatever reason. And I'll be like, oh, yeah, you know, I need to start doing that. I got to get better at that. And, you know, it's all going to help. nice progress. Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate you. I thought that was Kayla coughing when the dogs were born. Yeah, see, I'm telling you. Pretty much. We keep Kayla. She's here.
Keep her around the spirit.
She's here in spirit. Nipplegate and all. All right, updates on campaigns. We have, before we take a look at what Sean is going to share, we've got his book, Type 1, rocking and rolling.
Doing great.
We got sitting at, let me refresh this. I don't know if we refresh.
6,123 yes. Smackaroos, 87 backers, 15 days left on the second 30 of the campaign. If you like books that we talk about on ACPA, this book's up your alley. An action-adventure tale with real-life implication that faces off against terrorists from the past. Find out why the mysterious Type 1 armor chose Thomas DeHart and what connection he has to the Nine Lords of the Night from the Mayan Aztec lore. This is my love letter to 80s and 90s comics and cartoons and what people commonly now know as ancient aliens lores to mix into the storyline. According to the Mayan calendar, on December 12th, 2012, the world was supposed to end. From misdecoded translations from what was believed. But that wasn't the case at all. While it was a warning, it was something entirely different and much more severe than what was believed. Thoth of the Anunnaki created the Mesoamerican pyramids as not only conductors and regeneration chambers, but as also prisons for false gods, such as the Nine Lords of the Night. I got great variant covers from Phil McNulty, Chris Gray's of Ride and Pain, team up with Strees. Joe's going to be hard at working on his cover once he's done with Reaper Destroyer, so wait for that. We got a donation tier to donate a book to two children with diabetes. We have a tier for a book and original art sketch by yours truly. That's me. And then we have a four-pack where you can get all four of the covers and an add-on of 9-card trading cards. But that's not all. Joe, that's not all.
That's not all. Tell them what else.
The Ultimate One tier. The Ultimate One tier has everything you need. While, yes, it is a little bit pricey, it will be coming with all four covers, 9-card trading cards, original art sketch, and the only place you could get the Con Artist Volume 3, The Art of Type 1, which is a behind-the-scenes of my in-depth process of creating the book from where I kind of started out in 2020 to where I am now. And then pinups by various friends who donated art to me just to make it a cool book. Almost done working on the line art to that cover. And right now we are kicking ass and just taking names. And this is a fun experience. Once I'm done with this cover, I'm going to get back into working on the book. I have 21 pages of the 42 done. 21 of the 42. Do you know what that means, Joe?
You're almost halfway there.
I am. That is half.
I can't do math.
Yeah, that is half. We are halfway there. Like John Bon Jovi. Okay? Okay?
Whoa. Oh, nice. Cool.
Living on a one. So anyway, yeah, we're on progress. This story is so much fun to create. It's, I don't know, man. Like, creating comics is fun. Like being able to create your own path, your passion, your own world. Who's to say that I have to do something? Nobody, because it's my book.
That's right.
I am drawing and writing the book. I have Mark Poulton editing it. I have Dan Kemp. Oh, my God, Jamie. Yeah, I love
Jamie
you.
In the house.
Good to see you, darling. Good to see you. Dan Kemp of Spawn and Marvel and DC and everybody who created the coloring wheel of the digital game, coloring my book. Eric Weathers is lettering it. Eric Weathers. Get the Battle Brick Road Volume 2 now, live on Indiegogo. Yeah, I know. Allegedly. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, I know. But anyway, yeah, this book is awesome. Not trying to reinvent Shakespeare. I'm just trying to throw a ball of energy and excitement in your face, and that's what you're going to get in the pages of Type 1 Live now on Indiegogo.
I like this. Take my hand, I'll make a book, I swear. Leaving on the prayer. I like that. By the way, the donate a book tier goes to a child with diabetes. If you donate, or if you donate a book and you have evidence of that, evidence proof. By proof, as in you DM me, Sean, and or Kayla live on a stream that you backed a book, Kayla will do a shot for you. We're trying to do 100 books. Kayla's goal is to get 100 books as an entire floor of a facility, a hospital, or whatever. Two kids, and she's going to do 100 shots. That's what she's going to do. She's going to do it live on air, but you have to have the proof that you actually backed a book, and if she does, or if you do, she will do a shot for you.
And in the comic, I think we have 3?
Yeah, so we're doing good.
I'm not sure.
Right,
we're doing good.
We got
18,
16?
Maybe, but don't worry. Look, this book will close out. Listed. Oh, Mark.
Is he there?
Oh, I don't know. He's at the Phillies game. I don't know if he got home. But anyway, yeah. So even though the campaign is shut, the first 60 days is closing down, this book is going to be open for all year until I go to print, like Joe is doing Reaper Destroyer. I have no doubt in my mind that I will fulfill prior to expectation of the dates. I just wanted to give myself a good span just so I could dot my I's, cross all my T's as a first-time creator. If you backed both of my preview books, you know I deliver in a timely manner and keep you all updated via show and social media. So, art and stuff delivers. That's all I got to say.
Hell yeah.
Art and stuff delivers.
Hell yeah. Also, before we get out of here, you have this. You want to show everybody a little bit of update?
Yeah. So, this is the cover for Con Artist Volume 3, the Type 1. I got a little bit more to do on it. Just to finish it out. It's going to be colored by Dan Kemp, and just trying to go balls to the wall. I think it's pretty awesome. I'm really, really excited. I got some stuff, some adjustments to make, but we're going to get there. We're going to get there, and it's going to be awesome. And you can only get this via the Ultimate One tier on Indiegogo live now. # don't forget about Sean.
Hells yeah. Is what I have to say.
Yeah.
Tomorrow night, everybody, we will be back at 8, the new time for Ott and Stuff. 8:30 tomorrow.
Yes.
And we've got Nefarious and Adam Lawson jumping
nice.
On.
Nice.
Talk to them
nice.
About what's going on in their worlds. And I'll cook up some fun topic to talk about. I don't know. We will see. If not, we will be back here next Tuesday at the new time of 9:30. I haven't figured out what we want to look at yet, but if you guys enjoyed the show, and you want to, we could take a look at the David Finch Noman DVD if you want as well. That's a very awesome one if you like this. If not, I can dive into any of the number of comics I have over in the collection, and we can get back into the awesome appreciating comic book art live. So until then, everybody, thank you for being here in the chat. We love you guys. You're awesome as always. Thank you, everybody watching on Rumble. Everybody that's watching this live and anybody that will be watching this on the replay, remember to hit the like button, subscribe, hit the bell notification, so every time that we go live, you get notified so you can come check out amazing art from amazing artists from the comic books that we love. Recapture that love, everybody. Until then, be good to each other, take care of one another, and as always, picture me naked. Talk to you later. Peace.
He should do his duty, and to impress him takes on his multi-armed form and says, "Now I am become death, to destroy worlds."